Hachette Audio presents Opportunity Knocks: How Hard Work, Community, and Business Can Improve Lives and End Poverty. Written and read by Senator Tim Scott.
This book is dedicated to my grandparents, Artis and Louita Ware. When I was in the greatest need with nothing to offer, they took me in and loved me with the riches in their hearts while sharing their limited resources abundantly. To my mother, my living hero, thank you for your prayers, your encouragement, patience, and the constant love you gave me every single day. Without you, I do not exist. May God continue to bless you with exceedingly, abundantly, above all you can ask or imagine. Ephesians 3:20-21.
Chapter 1.
On a muggy, overcast September day in 2017, I stood in the cool, quiet bustle of the White House, just outside the Oval Office, waiting to see the President of the United States. In the wake of my negative critique of his comments on the race riot inspired by neo-Nazis in Charlottesville a few weeks earlier, Donald Trump had sent word that we needed to talk. In comments enthusiastically reported by the media, I had said that the president's statements compromised his moral authority and his reaction showed an insensitivity on racial issues. As the only Black Republican United States Senator, my comments had clearly struck a hot nerve with my Republican president. With me that day was Jennifer DeCasper, my chief of staff, who had accompanied me on the ride over from the Capitol. The ride was short in distance, but long in nervous anticipation of what we might face when we arrived. Jennifer had walked with me along some of our thornier paths throughout my time in Congress. Her faith and sharp wit seemed to make those walks easier. And now, there in the car, I told Jennifer that we needed to pray, to ask the Lord for clarity and guidance in this unusual, impossibly contentious meeting. She agreed that we needed to keep the Lord in the middle of all we were doing and then added, "Can you also ask that when this is over, I am still fully employable? I have a kid, you know." I had to smile, for I knew in my heart he would be with us all the way. To be sure, President Trump's displeasure over my comments had a political sting for me as well as for him. Trump was very popular in South Carolina, and plenty of my constituents were displeased with me and claimed that I had been unfair to Trump. So, it was important to me that I do my best to help the president understand why I strongly disagreed with his assessment and to look for some common ground. I hope that beneath his public bluster, the president felt the same way as I. In weighing this dicey situation, I kept in mind that there are some things more important than politics, namely that while there may be an ebb and flow in politics, I am going to be Black for the rest of my life. I have never doubted that the good Lord had a purpose in making me Black, and maybe it was just for such a time as this. For all of my life and for all of my family's heritage, we had tried to avoid being confrontational. Always, we believed, the primary aim should be to find common ground in order to move forward. As we made our way through the multiple layers of security checkpoints, I caught the eyes of almost everyone I interacted with. As they returned the glance, I wondered if they knew why I was there. Were the Black faces looking back at me, applauding me, hoping I would stand up for their invisible pain? Wondering if I would succeed? Did the white faces understand why I had to be there? Did they understand why this was important not only to me, but to all people of color, as well as to the spirit of our country? As we waited there in the White House for a few minutes, it all crystallized for me. The truth of who I am and how my direct ancestors survived the cruel Atlantic crossing from West Africa in the stinking, sweltering belly of slave ships reaching American soil in the early 1800s. My family's DNA places our origins in Nigeria or Cameroon. At the end of their terrible passage, It seems clear that my direct forebears set foot on American soil at Charleston. There, they were sold at auction into human bondage to spend the rest of their days, like beasts of burden, picking cotton in the broiling summer sun of South Carolina. Now I ask you to pause for a moment and consider what must have been the abject hopelessness of these people. Their utter despair as they were dispersed across a strange new world known as the American Southland. But somehow, and this is the divine hand of the Lord, as they settled into their new lives, some of them began to sense the tiniest flicker of hope in their hearts that right beyond their wretched present, things just might get a little better. It is impossible that any one of my ancestors envisioned a grand pageant in which the son of a son of a son of a slave would become a United States senator. More likely, the small hope was something more important to the moment, like maybe, just maybe, their master would give them an extra ration of meat for their Sunday meal. If my enslaved forebears had not been sustained by hope and faith, no matter how simple, then there would be no reason to keep picking cotton even to the end of the row. Just how my family got from then to now is an elusive journey that will never be known with any precision. Equally important is the fact that I will never understand the horrors of that journey. No matter how many prejudiced people I suffer, no matter how many offensive innuendos I encounter, I will never adequately appreciate what they endured. Whatever the details, I revere my ancestors for their courageous endurance and their faith that things might be better. I'm reminded of some advice I once got from Congressman John Lewis of Georgia, the legendary civil rights leader. He repeated some advice he had first shared with me in his office in 2011. This time, we were in Selma, Alabama at the Edmund Pettus Bridge. He was describing what happened on Bloody Sunday in March 1965. John Lewis described the snarling dogs and the fire hoses and how he was terribly beaten by the police and left unconscious on the pavement. It was heart-wrenching to hear the vivid, graphic observations from this courageous man who is my senior by a quarter of a century. And then he delivers some advice I've tried to live by. Never, ever become bitter, he said. This is wonderful advice that I have followed since my youth because of my faith. While I know and cherish the facts and forces that have made my success possible, I am also committed to never abandon my past. Indeed, that past is me and part of the steady continuum that is my present and future. I am committed to showing others how they too can come to taste and enjoy the fruits of the faith and principles that have girded who I am and how I got here. Still, as a descendant of those in bondage, I found it emotionally reassuring to be waiting to meet with the most powerful person in the world and to meet him on terms evened up by the full bloom of our nation's constitution. This, along with the hard political fact that I am the duly elected representative of more than 5 million American citizens in the state of South Carolina. No matter what happened in this meeting, I could not stand down from my belief that Trump's actual comments had shown a real insensitivity to the racial history of our country. But I knew I had to keep these swirling emotions at bay. One of the strong lessons of my grandfather, about whom you will read much in this book, is to never let your emotions lead your words. You have to be dispassionate if you want others to listen. You must purge the emotional toxicity out of the equation. My job was to speak with the authority that the good Lord had given me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.